Ich habe die Ehre, dazu einzuführen. Mein Name ist Katja Kipping. Ich spreche jetzt ausdrücklich nicht als eine von zwei Vorsitzenden der Linken, sondern als Mitglied des Vereins Rosa-Luxemburg-Stiftung. Sie ist die Veranstalterin dessen, was in den nächsten knappen zwei Stunden passiert. Ihr könnt es in dem Programmheft sehen, aber als allererstes will ich sagen, es gibt wieder das Angebot von Übersetzungsgeräten. Die Lecture von Chantal wird auf Englisch sein. Wer also Übersetzungsgeräte haben möchte, kann die sich abholen. Ja, genau, man muss einen Ausweis oder irgendeine ID als Pfand mit dalassen. Ich möchte an dieser Stelle Chantal Mouffe vorstellen, auch wenn man es wahrscheinlich gar nicht muss. Sie ist Professorin für politische Theorie. Chantal Mouffe hatte lange Zeit eine Professur für politische Theorie in London inne. Unzählige Forschungsaufenthalte, die aufzuzählen, würde schon den Rahmen springen. Ich bin auf sie gestoßen, wie wahrscheinlich die meisten, über wahrscheinlich ihr bekanntestes Werk, Hegemonie und radikale Demokratie, zur Dekonstruktion des Marxismus, das sie zusammen mit Ernesto Laclau verfasst hat, das 85 erschienen ist. Das gilt ja als Grundlagentext des Postmarxismus. Und nachdem ich dieses Buch gelesen hatte und dann im Vorfeld der Gipfelproteste in Heiligendamm dabei war, ein Buch herauszugeben, dachte ich, was wäre besser, als wenn man zu den strategischen Fragen auch Chantal Mouffe befragt. Ich schrieb also mit zittrigen Fingern eine E-Mail und dachte mir, das wird bestimmt nichts, aber sie hat prompt zugesagt und auch ganz schnell geliefert. Und ein weiteres Schlüsselwerk von ihr ist über das Politische erschienen in Deutsch 2007, wo es, ich glaube, das war zu dem Zeitpunkt eine ganz wichtige Aussage, als die Agenda 2010 kam, die Sozialdemokratie den dritten Weg pries, wo sie dezidiert darauf abstellt, dass es eine Freund-Feind-Trennung aus linker Sicht auch geben muss. Weiteres Werk, Exodus oder Stellungskrieg Zukunft radikaler Politik. Und ganz aktuell von ihr erschienen bei Surkamp ist Agonistik, die Welt politisch denken. Ich stelle das mal hier hin als kleines Product Placement. Wenn immer Chantal in Berlin ist, treffen wir uns auf einem Café oder zu einem Essen und ich bin da jedes Mal begeistert, weil Chantal ist quasi immer unterwegs und auf Achse und sehr umtriebig und verfolgt sehr genau, was gerade an Bewegung weltweit in Gang ist, wo was Neues entsteht und sich entwickelt. Und insofern ist es kein Wunder, dass sie die Entwicklung von Podemos in Spanien ganz eng verfolgt, ja begleitet hat. Erst kürzlich mit Pablo Iglesias im Internet-TV ein Gespräch, Interview in Spanisch geführt hat. Und die Werke von Chantal und Ernesto Laclau werden ja auch von Podemos als eine wichtige Inspirationsquelle genannt. Heute und hier soll es jetzt am Anfang um das neue große Thema von Chantal gehen, der Linkspopulismus. Wer am Freitag früh da war, als Bernd Rixinger und ich unser Zukunftsmanifest vorgestellt haben, wird den Begriff schon gehört haben. Wir haben auch darauf Bezug genommen. Ihr habt es bestimmt im Programmheft gesehen. Wir hatten das Programmheft geschrieben zu einem Zeitpunkt, wo wir dachten, es gibt noch eher ein Gespräch mit dem Wahlkampfleiter von Podemos. Wir haben jetzt etwas umgestellt. Es wird jetzt die Lecture von Chantal geben, danach die Möglichkeit zu nachfragen. Und dann haben wir gesagt, weil es aber auch so ein großes Interesse an Podemos direkt gibt, habe ich, und da bin ich ihm sehr dankbar, in letzter Minute Tom Kuchartz gewinnen können, der seit 16 Jahren, ich werde ihn noch einmal vorstellen, in Spanien lebt, Podemos da ganz nah auch begleitet hat und der uns dann nochmal einen Bericht und Einblick über die aktuelle Situation von Podemos gibt, wo wir auch wieder die Möglichkeit haben, nachzufragen, um womöglich aus beiden was mitzunehmen für unsere weitere politische Praxis. Und jetzt erst einmal herzlich willkommen, Chantal Mouffe.
Very much, Katja. It's really a pleasure to be here in this meeting to discuss the future of the left. Well, I'm going to f- first examine our current situation. Sorry?
Louder.
Louder? Louder? So it's okay? Everybody can hear me at the back? Yes, let me just make this. Okay. So, I'm going to begin examining the present state of our societies, which unfortunately is not very, is okay, yes? What do you mean, you don't hear? But you could hear Katya, so it's why isn't? Yeah, but I don't have much space for my. Okay. So what's the problem? Because my voice is already normally quite high. Closer? Yeah, but then I can't see my paper if it's too close. I don't know. I mean, this is very bizarre. I mean, yeah, but you see, this is it okay now? Is it not still not okay? I mean, but what's the problem with this? Are they trying to arrange something? It's okay? Ah, okay, good. So when we envisage the present state of democracy, one of the assertions that we often come across is that our current condition is one of post-democracy. The meaning conveyed by this notion of post-democracy, I mean, one of the person who developed this idea is, of course, Colin Crouch, I think is known in it, is that modern democracies, our actual democracies, while maintaining the facade of formal democratic principle, are increasingly controlled by privileged elites. The implementation of neoliberal policies has led to the colonization of the state by corporate interests, and crucial political decisions are now taken outside the traditional democratic channels. The loss of legitimacy of democratic institutions manifests itself in a growing phenomenon of depoliticization. Well, that's very roughly, you know, said what post-democracy is. Well, I agree with many aspects of this analysis, but I think that when we examine the reason for this phenomenon of post-democracy, and particularly envisage how this tendency can be reversed, it is important to stress the role that parties of the left have played in the process of disaffection with democratic politics. In On the Political, book, Word as Politician, I have examined the reason for what I call the post-political perspective, which has become dominant in liberal democratic societies. Post-political and post-democracies goes in the same direction, but it's not the same thing, because post-democracy insists more on the economic transformation, while post-political is to examine, you know, the state of the politics more, and particularly the role of parties. Well, so I have argued in On the Political that this post-political situation is linked to the move towards the center, which in the late decade have been the strategy of social democratic parties in Europe. Strategy with under the motto of the third way was first elaborated by New Labour in Britain by Anthony Giddens and put in practice by Tony Blair, and then of course put in practice here in Germany by Gerhard Schröder. And according to such an approach, Western societies have entered what they call a second stage of modernity, one of reflexive modernization, where the adversarial model of politics, which was characteristic of the first stage of modernity, what they call simple modernization, has become obsolete. Means that there is no more antagonism, and Giddens claim that it is no necessary to think beyond left and right. I mean, in fact, it's the title of one of his books, and envisage a new type of politic of the radical center, which transcend the old-fashioned divide between left and right. It said, no, I mean, there is no more antagonism, no more collective identities, role of parties, trade union, all that, it became really archaic. Well, such a view, unfortunately, was later adopted by other socialist and social democratic parties, which, and that, you know, became no pervasive in all of Europe, and those parties began to present themselves now at center-left. They don't want to be left. They are center-left. And that, of course, clearly indicates that they were rejecting their former anti-capitalist element. Because, of course, there has always been a difference, you know, with respect to the critique of capitalism in social democratic and Marxist parties. But traditional social democracy did have some element of anti-capitalism. And this is precisely what has been abandoned by the center-left parties. Under the pretense of modernizing the social democratic project so as to adapt it to a globalized world, center-left parties, in fact, have capitulated to neoliberalism. Convinced that there was no alternative anymore to the current form of globalized financial capitalism, they have accepted the framework that was established by neoliberal hegemony. Having abandoned any attempt to challenge the existing relation of power, they now limit themselves to propose ways to humanize, so to speak, neoliberal globalization. Little more redistribution than center-right parties, but basically, you know, they do not put into question the hegemony of neoliberalism. And of course, this is why their policies are very hard to distinguish from those of the center-right parties. You know, center-left, center-right, basically, is a variation of the same team. Well, it is my contention that this consensus at the center has very negative consequences for democratic politics. Indeed, it is the absence of a real choice between clearly distinguishable alternatives which explain the current lack of interest for politics, which, of course, has produced a drastic fall in participation and in many countries, abstention has become a growing phenomenon. And another consequence of the convergence between center-right and center-left is that in several countries, such a situation has favored the emergence of right-wing populist parties whose success is due to the fact that they appear as being the only one that offer an alternative to the existing order. You know, they put into question what they see the establishment, center-right, center-left, and say, we are going to give the people a right to speak, to decide. We are going to represent the interest of the people, and there is an alternative to this situation. When it seemed to me that in the discussion about post-democracy, the role played by this post-political situation is not sufficiently taken into account. It is, of course, necessary to grasp the transformation of the capitalist system, which have provided the economic condition for the success of neoliberal globalization. But that does not automatically explain the reason for the disappearance of a vibrant democratic debate about the different ways in which social relations and public institutions can be organized. And this is where I think the responsibility of parties of the left need to be recognized. By failing to acknowledge that politics is intrinsically partisan and that democratic politics require what I've called in my work an agonistic debate among conflicting projects, and a choice between real alternative. An agonistic debate is precisely when you've got different projects, you know, which are confronting each other, and when the citizen, when they go to election, they've got the possibility to vote between different projects. That's an agonistic debate. When citizens feel that they cannot have a say in the fundamental decision which concerns their common affair, and that political questions are dealt with by experts because they are considered of a technical nature, democratic institutions are emptied of their substance and their legitimacy is threatened. I mean, here there is a clear progression between the idea that there is no alternative to neoliberal globalization. So in fact, there is no more possibility of making real political decisions, you know, choice between alternatives. So if that is the case, of course, it means that political issue have become technical issue, no real choice to be made, and of course, it's expert arbiter to deal with those. And I think so this is really what explains the current situation. Elections are reduced to providing a rubber stamp for measures imposed by a variety of actors whose interests are not publicly accountable and the democratic process has lost its raison d'être. So this is why I think we can really speak of a post-democracy. To be sure, our society still claims to be democratic. But what is the meaning of democracy in our post-political times? Scrutinizing the nature of liberal democracy, well, here I want to insist, when I speak of liberal democracy, I'm not speaking of liberal capitalism. I'm speaking of a political regime. So I'm speaking of the articulation between democratic, the idea of democracy and the idea of political regime. No, the state of law, the separation of power, leaving completely aside the question of, you know, what is the economic system, because that can be articulated differently. So in fact, sometimes I prefer to speak, to refer to our current Western model to speak of pluralist democracy. But liberal democracy, plural democracy, you must insist, I insist, understand that I'm not referring to the liberal capitalism. So in The Democratic Paradox, which is a book previous to Über das Politische, I brought to the fore the tension existing between what I call the two ethico-political principles of pluralist democracy, liberty and equality. Liberal democracy should be understood, in fact, as the articulation of two different traditions. On one side, the liberal tradition of the rule of law, the individual rights, and on the other side, the democratic tradition of popular sovereignty. The Canadian political theorist C.B. McPherson has shown how through the articulation between those two traditions, liberalism and democracy, and an articulation that was established during the 19th century and through struggle because liberal forces and more democratic forces, in fact, joined forces against absolutism, and he said through that liberalism was democratized, democracy was liberalized, and this is, you know, the basis of our present system. However, there was always a tension between the exigencies of liberty and the exigencies of equality, because those are things which cannot perfectly be reconciled. Contrary to Habermas, I don't believe that there is a co-originality. There is a tension because perfect equality and perfect liberty cannot be realized at the same time. So there was always a tension, and in fact it is this tension which is provided up till now the confrontation between left and right, left putting more emphasis on equality and right on liberty. In fact, the history of democratic politics can be visualized in terms of the struggle for the predominance of one of those principles over the other. In some period, the liberal aspect was dominant, in other, it was the democratic one. But the contestation always remained open. Well, what has happened with the current hegemony of neoliberalism is that the liberal component, and liberal component understood in a very specific way, which is, you know, the difference between traditional liberalism and neoliberalism. This liberal component has become so dominant that the democratic one has almost disappeared. Democracy is now understood simply in terms of rule of law and defense of human rights. And the very idea of popular sovereignty has been relinquished as being obsolete. Those who resist the rule of the elites and insist on the need to give a voice to the people to make room for their demand are dismissed as being populist. In my view, this displacement of the democratic tradition by the liberal one is one of the main features of our post-democratic condition. And it is clearly visible in the abandon by center-left parties of the struggle for equality. Their main slogans are now about choice, fairness, equity, inclusion, but they take pains to avoid speaking of equality because they consider equality as being too tainted by the equalitarianism of the socialist ideal that they have repudiated. Deprived of the vocabulary that really constitute the backbone of its vision of society, because at the center, of course, of the idea of the left should be the idea of equality. It's not surprising that the left is now unable to envisage an alternative to neoliberal globalization. So my claim is that without abandoning the consensus at the center politics, which is one of the causes of the progressive irrelevance of democratic institutions, there is no hope of escaping the post-democratic, post-political trend. It is necessary to fight against the blurring of the line between left and right. I mean, I'm not denying that empirically there's been such a blurring, but the question is that, is it something good, progressive, progress for democracy, or bad? And I think that, of course, you know, such a blurring, for me, Patchett, what Thurgood theorists have claimed, does not constitute a progress for democracy. It's not democracy become more mature because there is no more, you know, difference between left and right, as they claim. But in fact, I claim that it could lead to the demise of democracy. And already with our post-democracy, we are seeing an advance into that direction. So I think that it's important to realize it is urgent to revive the democratic process. And this can only be done by parties providing, well, parties, you know, let's call it left, or, but certainly not center-left, launching a counter-hegemonic offensive against the neoliberal attempt to destroy the central institution of the welfare state, to privatize the whole of social life, subjecting it to the rule of the market. My diagnostic is what we are witnessing is really a crisis of representation. And this is the consequence of the consensus at the center that has come to dominate politics in most liberal democratic societies. This consensus, which I repeat, is the result of the unchallenged hegemony of neoliberalism, deprives democratic citizens of an agonistic debate where they can make their voice heard and choose between real alternatives. So this is an analysis of, you know, situation of the post-democratic one. Well, it's interesting to see that till recently, the rejection of this consensus at the center, the putting into question of the establishment, had come principally from right-wing populist parties. And it had been articulated in a xenophobic language. Fortunately, we have recently begun to witness a different kind of challenge, thanks first to the development of a variety of protest movements like the Indignados in Spain or the different form of Occupy. With those protests, we have seen the emergence of other ways, certainly much more estimable, of reacting against the democratic deficit that characterized our post-democratic societies. People have lost faith in traditional parties, and they feel that their voice cannot be heard through traditional political channels. It's one of the motto of the Indignados in Spain claim, we have a vote, but we don't have a voice. Tenemos voto, pero no tenemos voz. And I think that's really the case, you know, because if you have a vote between center-right and center-left who propose the same thing, you don't have a voice. And that is the basis of the crisis of representation that I'm referring to. So let's say this is something which is important, that is not only, you know, on the kind of the right that this establishment is put to question, but also on the form of, let's call it left, even if those people would not necessarily want to accept this term. But of course, there are different interpretations about those recent protests. So everybody in a sense, you know, said, yeah, that's important, but what they should be interpreted. I mean, there is some kind of agreement on the fact that those protests reveal a profound malaise vis-à-vis democratic institutions. They bring to the fore the crisis of those institutions. But it is with respect to the cause of such a crisis and particularly the remedies that are needed that opinion diverge. Many theories influenced by the approach put forward by Antonio Negri and Michael Hart in their trilogy Empire, Multitude and Commonwealth. And this approach is being called the Exodus approach. Those who are influenced by this approach see in the recent mobilization a manifestation of the power of what I call the multitude, constructing new form of social relation outside traditional institutions. They celebrate those movements of the realization of the common and present their encampments as a prefiguration of what Hart and Negri call absolute democracy. For them, those movements are characteristic of the new form of struggle of the precarious worker, typical of post-Fordism, and they argue that what the indignados, with their call for democracia realia, real democracy, already, advocate, they say, is not so much a direct democracy, but in fact, radically different understanding of democracy, a democracy beyond representation, a democracy in actu, and sometimes they call it a presentist democracy, because they say direct democracy is still too representative. So we need something which is really, you know, presentist democracy. Presentist democracy, in their view, the opposite of representative democracy. It's a matter of collective political practices without any claim to government. They are against any form of representation altogether, and they express a total rejection of representative democracy. Well, in Agonistic, I have proposed a different kind of interpretation. In my view, understood as refusal of the post-political order, I mean, that's up for sure, current protests can be read for radicalization of liberal democratic institutions, not for their rejection. What they exact are better, more inclusive for form of representation. To satisfy their demand for voice, existing representative institutions have to be transformed, and new one, of course, need to be established so as to create the condition for an agonistic confrontation where the citizen will be offered real alternative. And such a confrontation requires not a strategy of exodus, a strategy of withdrawal from existing institutions, but a strategy of engagement with those institutions. A strategy, what one can call, using Gramsci's system, a strategy of, Stellungkrieg, the war of position, you know, engaging with the institution in order to transform them, not withdrawing from those institutions. And this is what I call a strategy of radicalization of democracy. And it requires the emergence of a progressive project able to offer an alternative to the social liberal consensus dominant in center-left parties. And of course, that's a project I'm going to argue in a moment is precisely how I envisage left-wing populism. But before, I want to say something about the question of representation because I think it's important. I prefer to call those protests some kind of citizen awakening. And I think this, of course, is something which is very positive, this citizen awakening that we've seen in Europe and the US. It's very encouraging because it breaks with the post-political consensus. A taboo has been broken and many voices are now being heard, contesting the inequalities existing in our societies. But to effectively challenge neoliberal hegemony, it is crucial that all the energy that have erupted through those movements are not diverted towards wrong allies. And I'm afraid that this is what could happen if representative institutions, you know, per se, become the target of the protests. There is no denying that representative institutions are in crisis in their current post-democratic, liberal democratic form. But I do not believe that the solution resides in the establishment of a non-representative democracy, or for that matter, that civil society movement, you know, on their own, they are the only vehicle for making democratic advances. Such a view, of course, are popular because they chime with the idea, which is fashionable among certain sectors of the left, that the multitude could auto-organize itself, avoiding taking power and avoiding becoming state. I must say that to find such an anti-political approach among activists involved in the various movements of the outrage is worrying, because it forecloses the possibility of designing an adequate strategy for their struggle. When representation is seen as the problem, the aim cannot be to engage with current institutions to make them more representative, more accountable, but to discard them entirely. And the objective of the movement will be, of course, visualized in terms of an exodus from the different forms of democracy on the ground that attempting to transform existing institutions is vain and that representative democracy is to be relinquished. Many among those who reject representation, non-representative democracy, of course, they identify representative democracy with its current post-democratic form and with the actual working of the parliamentary system. They do not see that the problem concerns the way representative institutions function at the moment, not, you know, the very fact of representation. What needs to be challenged is the lack of alternative offered to the citizen, not the very idea of representation. A pluralist democratic society cannot exist without representation. To begin with, as the anti-essentialist approach, that's the approach that we develop in the book that Katia referred to, the book with Ernesto Lacroix, Hegemony and Socialist Strategy, they propose an anti-essentialist approach, and this approach insist that identities are never already given, but always produced, constructed, discursively constructed, produced through identification. This process of identification is a process of representation. It is through representation that collective political subjects are created, and they do not exist beforehand. Every assertion of a political identity is thereby interior, not exterior, to the process of representation. So that's the first point. And secondly, in a democratic society where pluralism is not envisaged in the harmonious anti-political form, you know, of possibility of total harmony, and where the ever-present possibility of antagonism is taken into account, in such a society, representative institutions, by giving form to the division of society, play a crucial role in allowing for the institutionalization of the conflictual dimension. However, such a role can only be fulfilled through the availability of an agonistic confrontation. And what constitutes the central problem in our current post-political model is the absence of such an agonistic confrontation. And of course, this is not going to be remedied through horizontalist practices. Well, I want to make clear here, I'm not, you know, saying that those horizontalist practices do not have some importance, and I think they do have a role to play in an agonistic democracy. But what I contend is that those practices, beside the fact that, by the way, they always entail some element of representation, they cannot provide a substitute for representative institutions, and that it is necessary to establish a synergy between those form of horizontalist practices and the more institutional, let's call them verticalist, form of struggle. If protest movements refuse to establish alliances with traditional political channels, you know, understood parties or trade unions, deemed as intrinsically impervious to democratic transformation, their radical potential will be lost. And I'm going to say that, amazingly, some activists are still celebrating the horizontalist experience in Argentina in 2001, presenting them as the model to follow without acknowledging the limit of such a strategy. They do not seem to realize that the democratic advances that have taken